This video is sponsored by The Great Courses Plus. More on that to come shortly. In addition, this video is also a Carthage-inspired collab with both History Time and Stefan Milo. Check out the links to their videos in the description below. By the midpoint of the 3rd century BC, the Western Mediterranean was in turmoil. In little over a century, a new power had emerged from the warring cities of central Italy. Its name was Rome, a state like no other, where every man owed military service and the economy of war held sway. In the face of near constant opposition, it had succeeded in annexing most of Italy, had defeated the Greek cities of the south, and had even triumphed over a foreign invader without winning a single battle. Now, with Italy within its grasp, it stood poised to expand its territory to the islands of Sardinia, Corsica, Sicily, and beyond. But in its way stood another power, the great maritime empire of Carthage. Unmatched on the seas, this state stretched from its heartlands in northern Africa to the shores of the Balearics and Spain. In Sicily, it sought to extend its territory to the east and to deny a foothold to any foreign invader. The result of these competing ambitions were three wars, the first two of which were fought on such a gigantic scale that their impact would be felt for centuries to come. In just over 50 years, millions of men would clash on both land and sea, and hundreds of thousands more would perish. Ultimately, both nations came near to collapse. Rome would see its citizenry cut almost in half, whilst across the sea, Carthage's great wealth was slowly eaten away. And beyond Rome or Carthage, the result of these wars would change the entire structure of the ancient world. The victor would be free to turn its gaze eastwards to the nations of Greece and Anatolia. And less than a century later, a new order would reign across much of the Mediterranean. The Punic Wars hold a momentous place in the history of the Mediterranean. Beginning as a small-scale conflict between the rapidly expanding Roman Republic and the sprawling maritime empire of Carthage, the first war between these powers would grow to include most of the islands of the Western Mediterranean. After 20 years of war on land and sea, the longest conflict in Roman history, both powers would be brought to the brink of exhaustion. A quarter of a century later, the two powers would fight a second war on an even grander scale, with armies marching into Spain, northern Africa, and deep into the heart of the Italian peninsula. This conflict, dubbed Hannibal's War by the Romans, saw the eponymous general cross the Alps with his army, taking the fight to Rome in its very heartlands. Here he would inflict a string of grievous defeats on his enemies, and in the process acquire a reputation amongst ancient authors as one of the great battlefield commanders of his day. But despite these victories, the Carthaginians failed to force a peace. Over the next decade, the balance of war would swing back and forth, with Carthage scoring victories in southern Italy and Rome prevailing in the north and to the west in Iberia. After 17 straight years of warfare, the end came in Africa. In 204 BC, the Romans succeeded in landing an army on its shores. And after a string of victories, Hannibal was recalled to Africa, but to no avail. After its defeat at the Battle of Zama, Carthage was forced to give in. Rome's victory was total. Freed now to focus on its wars to the east, the next century would see Rome's ascension as the leading power of its age. Carthage would limp on for several decades, but its time as a great power was over. Finally, a third conflict spelled Carthage's end. After a siege that lasted nearly 3 years, its walls were breached, and for 6 days the Romans slaughtered its citizens. The city was burnt to the ground, and its surviving populace was sold into slavery. At long last, Carthage had been destroyed. Yet it all could have gone very differently. Throughout the course of both the First and the Second Punic Wars, the Carthaginians would make Rome pay a heavy price for their victories, which would have forced many a lesser power to sue for peace. In the First Punic War alone, Rome would suffer several major setbacks, including a failed invasion of Africa, loss of multiple fleets to storms, and a crushing defeat at the Battle of Drepana. Second Punic War in particular would see Rome come close to collapse. After the catastrophic envelopment of its legions at the Battle of Cannae, Rome was left with no effective army to defend its capital from Hannibal's forces. Throughout southern Italy, many of its allies defected to the Carthaginians, whilst in Greece new players entered the war on their enemy's side. Yet on each occasion, the Romans stubbornly refused to make any peace short of total victory. Slowly regaining their former position, they would continue these wars by attrition, until eventually Carthage could no longer continue. To achieve these results, Rome would send thousands more men to their deaths. By the time of the Third War, however, such methods were no longer required, and all Carthage could do was delay the inevitable. Throughout the course of this series, we will journey through the cataclysmic events of the Punic Wars. We'll start by familiarising ourselves with the activities of both Rome and Carthage in the centuries prior to the beginning of the wars, and see for ourselves how their respective battle lines were drawn. From there, we'll take a look at each war in turn, examining their key events, their major players, and their ramifications for the rest of the ancient world. With the conclusion of the Second Punic War, we will see the ascendancy of Rome throughout the Western Mediterranean, and the confiscation of Carthage's navy and overseas territories. Finally, in the mid-2nd century BC, we will see the destruction of the city of Carthage itself, an event that marked the end of a civilization that had lasted for more than 6 centuries. Let's begin then by examining the more famous of the two powers. The Rome that most people are familiar with today is either that of the late Roman Republic during the wars of Julius Caesar, Pompey, and Augustus, or the succeeding Roman Empire, which ruled most of Europe, Northern Africa, and the Near East for another 4 centuries. Before the 5th century BC, however, Rome appears to have been a fairly undistinguished city-state, that at the most would have exercised hegemony over the other cities of Latium. This began to change, however, around 500 BC, when the city experienced a prolonged period of warfare with its surrounding peoples. In particular, a severe famine seems to have resulted in many Latin cities expelling large amounts of young men, who would have formed roving bands of raiders throughout the region. For the next century, Rome seems to have been at war on an almost annual basis, with the city itself sometimes falling under siege. By the beginning of the 4th century BC, this constant warfare had crafted Rome into a highly aggressive state, where every male citizen owed military service regardless of his status within Roman society. According to historian John Cerati, however, Rome only seems to have made the transition from raiders to conquerors after the fall of the nearby city of Veii to their forces in 396 BC. Rather than taking control of the city, the Romans instead chose to destroy it, selling its people into slavery and distributing its land amongst their populace. From this point thereafter, the acquisition of treasure in the form of either slaves or land seems to have become the primary goal of Roman warfare, one which required wholesale conquest of their enemies. In either 390 or 387 BC, Rome would face another calamity altogether. That year the city was sacked by a migrating band of Gauls, who were only expelled with great difficulty. In the decades afterwards, however, Rome would recover from this defeat to launch a seemingly endless series of expansionist wars. By 358 BC, the city had succeeded in formalising its leadership over the rest of the cities of the Latin League, after which it turned its attention to the other peoples of both central and southern Italy. Using their now vastly increased base of manpower in Latium, the Romans now fought a series of wars against the neighbouring Samnite Confederacy, along with simultaneous conflicts against the Etruscans and the Umbrians to the north, and the Campanians to the south. By the end of the Third Samnite War, Rome had managed not only to pacify each of these powers, but had succeeded in disassembling the Latin League entirely. Some of these territories were then wholly incorporated into the Roman Republic, whilst the remainder were bound to the Roman state through a series of treaties. In exchange for retaining a degree of independence in their internal matters, these allies ceded all control over their foreign affairs to Rome. The Romans also incorporated the armed forces of each state into their own, swelling their manpower reserves even further. And in addition to these dependent states, the Romans continued their long-standing practice of setting up colonies of their own citizens throughout conquered territories, where they would act as watchdogs over these peoples. Finally, and perhaps most crucially, these allies were also granted a share in the spoils of any war they fought in, granting them a stake in Rome's continued expansion. With much of central Italy now under its domination, Rome turned its gaze towards the wealthy Greek city-states of southern Italy. In 280 BC, provoked by a series of border skirmishes between the two forces, the city of Tarentum appealed for aid to the kingdom of Epirus, located across the sea in what is now modern Albania and Greece. Ruled by Pyrrhus, an experienced military adventurer, this state could boast a large mercenary army outfitted on the model of the city-states of Greece. Eager to extend his power to southern Italy, Pyrrhus willingly answered Tarentum's call. The next year he and his army crossed the sea, where they met the Romans at the Battle of Heraclea. Facing a professional army for the first time, the Romans were narrowly defeated, and Pyrrhus was able to press home his advantage with a more substantial victory at Asculum later that same year. In the process, however, the Romans inflicted large casualties on the king's army, which he struggled to replace. With the Romans stubbornly refusing to entertain any idea of peace, Pyrrhus diverted to Sicily, where he warred against Carthage. In 275 BC, he again returned to southern Italy, where he was fought to a standstill at the Battle of Beneventum. Lacking the manpower to continue the war, he abandoned his allies and returned to Epirus in 272 BC. Tarentum and the other Greek cities soon capitulated, and Rome took control of southern Italy. As Rome expanded and developed, so too did its institutions. By the beginning of the 3rd century BC, the government of the early Roman state had coalesced into a form that would remain largely stable throughout the remainder of the Republic's lifespan. The chief executives of the state were the two annually elected consuls, who held combined executive power and acted as the overall commanders of armies in the field. Alongside these were the Senate, the supreme decision-making body of the Roman state, which advised the consuls, managed foreign policy and the treasury, and also discussed and passed decrees. Finally, the Senate was balanced by a number of popular assemblies. These assemblies were charged with giving legislative power to their decrees, with electing the consuls and the other officers of the Roman state, and with the power to declare war. In theory, the decisions of these assemblies were decided by the votes of individual citizens. However, the specific system of voting meant that their decisions were heavily weighted towards those of the wealthy. The result was an oligarchic system, with the affairs of the state largely controlled by the aristocracy. So by 270 BC, Rome had succeeded in subjugating all of central and southern Italy, and in the process had brought a vast amount of wealth and resources into its coffers. Along the way to these victories, however, it had also suffered a number of significant setbacks and defeats. In fact, what marks Roman warfare during this period more than anything is just how adept their forces became at rebounding from military defeats. Combined with this was a stubborn refusal to accept defeat in even the direst of circumstances, along with a willingness to resort to wars of attrition that none of its neighbours could match. And despite the human cost of these wars, the steady increase of plunder from Rome's conquests only increased the appeal of war for both the aristocracy and the common people of Rome alike. At the same time, the growing prestige attached to warfare also increased competition amongst the aristocracy for military posts. In most cases, these posts would have been appointed on an annual basis, limiting the amount of time that each commander had to further his career. The result was that it was often in the interests of a particular general to act aggressively in the field. In doing so, each man would have hoped to advance his political career, and to even receive the greatest of all possible Roman honours, a military triumph and its attendant parade. The end result of all of this was an openly imperialistic society, able to exist in a state of near perpetual warfare. At the same time that Rome was extending its territory across the Italian peninsula, the rival power of Carthage was consolidating its influence throughout much of the Western Mediterranean. Located on the northern coast of modern Tunisia, Carthage was only one of many colonies set up by the Phoenician city-states of the Near East during this time. This group of cities, which were based primarily in modern Lebanon, controlled a large proportion of the seaborne trade within the Eastern Mediterranean, which brought them substantial wealth and power. After reaching their zenith in the 9th century BC, the Phoenicians had come under increased threat from their vastly larger neighbour, the Neo-Assyrian Empire. To retain their political independence, these cities would be forced to pay increasingly large tributes to their more powerful neighbour, and to pay this tribute, even greater trading opportunities were required. The result was the seeding of multiple Phoenician colonies throughout the Western Mediterranean, the goals of both exploiting the existing trade in this region, whilst also acquiring the valuable raw materials that the Assyrians demanded. With the exception of a few mythological tales, we have very little written information about the early history of Carthage, and must instead turn to archaeology to fill the gap. Going by carbon 14 dating, we can say with some certainty that Carthage was founded around the last third of the 9th century BC, as a colony of the Phoenician city of Tyre. As with many Phoenician colonies, the layout of Carthage seems to have been carefully planned from the beginning, with efficient administrative structures present in its earliest layers. Over the next century, settlement would experience rapid but fairly orderly growth, and by the end of the 8th century BC, it would already have been recognisable as a city with a high degree of autonomy from Tyre. Over the next three centuries, Carthage continued to expand its territory in northern Africa, along with its influence over the trade of the Phoenician colonies of Sicily, Sardinia, Corsica, and along the Spanish coast to the west. During the same period, the Carthaginians would also have formed contacts with other groups, including the Etruscans and Latins of central and northern Italy, and Greek colonies throughout the western Mediterranean. In 573 BC, Tyre and the other Phoenician cities of the east largely lost their independence to a new power, the Neo-Babylonian Empire. With the capture of these centres, many of the Phoenician cities of the west went into prolonged economic decline. For Carthage, however, the fall of its mother city presented new opportunities. Situated on the prime trade routes between northern Africa and the islands of the western Mediterranean, the city was now the largest and the wealthiest of the former Phoenician colonies, and was in a prime position to dominate the trade of the other centres. In many earlier historical works, the 6th century BC supposedly saw the establishment of a new imperial order throughout the former Phoenician colonies, with Carthage enforcing its control through military force. However, the archaeological record tells us a very different story. Whilst there are substantial signs of unrest throughout many of the former Phoenician territories, there is little sign of any violent imposition of Carthaginian rule. Instead, the actual territory of Carthage itself seems to have remained limited to northern Africa throughout the 6th century BC, the city instead exerting economic and cultural influence over the other Phoenician cities. As a result, many of these cities slowly developed a Carthaginian-inspired culture, and adopted a variant of the Phoenician language known as Punic. In the 5th century BC, however, this relationship would change, and there are signs that Carthage was becoming more assertive over the other Phoenician centres of the western Mediterranean. In Africa, the Carthaginians expanded both to the east, where they would sign treaties with the native Libyan tribes, and to the west, where it came to similar accommodations with the local Numidian kingdoms. Sardinia also appears to have become a major supply of foodstuffs to Carthage during this period, and the tightening of Punic control here can be seen by the arrival of a sizeable number of Punic settlers throughout the second half of the 5th century BC. In Sicily, however, this increase in Carthaginian engagement was largely due to the threat posed to the Phoenician cities by an emerging power in the island's politics, the Greek city of Syracuse to the east. After answering a call for aid by the Phoenician cities of western Sicily against the Greeks, Carthage would spend much of the next two centuries embroiled in a series of wars against successive Syracusan rulers, including the tyrants Gelon, Dionysius, and Agathocles. Each of these rulers would attempt to expel the Carthaginians from the island entirely, with Agathocles even going so far as to invade the Carthaginian heartlands in Africa in aid of this goal. Ultimately, this invasion force would fail, and the result of each of these wars was largely a restoration of the status quo. Carthage remained in control of the Phoenician centres in the west of the island, the most notable of these being the port cities of Lilybaeum, Panormus, and Drepana. The result of these wars was that by the end of the 4th century BC, the Carthaginians had come to see these western areas of Sicily not simply as allied cities, but more as a vital part of their own territory. With this also came a greater military commitment to the region, with increasing amounts of Carthaginian troops being stationed there year-round. This sense of ownership is perhaps best demonstrated during Pyrrhus's raids on Carthaginian territory in the 3rd century BC. After his victories against the Romans, he chose to come to the aid of Syracuse in 278 BC. Within 2 years, he had succeeded in reducing Carthaginian territory to the city of Lilybaeum in the west of the island, which could not have been taken without the support of a substantial fleet. Carthage appears to have sued for peace at this point, only to reject Pyrrhus's terms after he demanded their complete expulsion from the island. The next year, after failing to gather enough local support to mount his own invasion of Africa, Pyrrhus returned to Italy. Legend has it that as he departed, he said the following words.
"My friends, what a wrestling ground for Carthaginians and Romans we are now leaving behind us."
Soon after, Carthaginian territory on the island returned to its old borders, where it remained until the outbreak of the First Punic War. By the beginning of the 3rd century BC, Carthage had clearly moved from being the economic and cultural hegemon of the other Phoenician colonies of the west to the possessor of a large maritime empire. In addition to controlling the whole coast of northern Africa between Cyrenaica and the edge of the Atlantic, it also held significant sections of Sicily, Sardinia, Corsica, and according to some sources, parts of the Balearic Islands and southern Spain. This combined territory would have held a comparable population to that of the contemporary Roman territories, though it would have been separated by a far greater range of languages and ethnicities. In the city of Carthage itself, the governing institutions seem to have resembled those of Rome. According to Aristotle, the Carthaginians also elected a hierarchy of officials for a term of a single year, who were expected to support themselves financially throughout their time in office. The most important of these were the suffetes, or judges, two of whom seem to have been elected at any one time. Unlike Rome, these positions seem to have had no associated military command, with separate generals being elected to conduct military affairs. In addition to these officials, there was also a council of elders, often referred to as a senate by Roman authors, along with a group of committees who appear to have been the main shapers of state policy. Finally, as in Rome, there appears to have been some form of people's council, although there also appears to have been no great commitment by the suffetes or the various committees to consult them. Here, however, the resemblance largely ends. Unlike Rome and its tightly controlled system of allies, Carthage's empire appears to be more loosely organised. In subject areas such as Libya and Numidia, Carthaginian rule seems to have been limited to the provision of tribute, taxes, and troops for its armies, although the total amount of resources extracted seems to have been high. In Sicily and Sardinia, the former Phoenician colonies appear to have retained their own institutions and rights, though they would have been subject to Carthaginian taxation. With the exception of officers, Carthaginian citizens also seem to have been exempt from overseas military service. The result of all this is that whilst Carthage would have had comparative manpower reserves to those of Rome, it would have had more difficulty mobilising them. Instead, Carthage would largely rely on its African forces during wartime, along with what are described as mercenaries by both Roman and Greek authors. Finally, as a maritime empire, Carthage also placed far more emphasis on its navy than Rome. And indeed, as we will see, it had previously been a major innovator in shipbuilding techniques and naval warfare. The result is that at the outbreak of the First Punic War, Carthage would have enjoyed a large advantage in both fleet size and experience. So by the year 270 BC, we see the emergence of the battle lines that would be drawn between Rome and Carthage. The former now controlled all but the northernmost reaches of the Italian peninsula, whilst the latter were well entrenched in Sardinia and in the western and southern parts of Sicily. But despite the increasing proximity of the two powers, at this point there is little evidence of any impending war between the two. In fact, prior to the beginning of the First Punic War, Carthage and Rome had been more often allies and trading partners than opponents. Between the 6th and the 4th centuries BC, Rome and Carthage even seem to have signed a number of economic and diplomatic treaties, the earliest of which dates from between 509 and 507 BC. This treaty, which would have been signed whilst Rome was still a small city-state, was a fortuitous one for Carthage. In return for banning Roman access to northern Africa and severely restricting their trade in both Sardinia and Sicily, Carthage pledged not to harm any Latin city aligned with Rome, nor to establish any form of foothold in Latium itself. Later treaties were also signed in 348 BC, when Rome was establishing its dominance in central Italy, and in 306 BC, at the end of the Second Samnite War. Supposedly this latter treaty included a clause that Rome would keep clear of Sicily, whilst Carthage would do the same for Italy, though its existence is disputed amongst ancient authors. A final treaty was signed between the two around 278 BC, during Pyrrhus' wars in southern Italy and Sicily. Whilst the exact text of this agreement is difficult to understand, it seems that this treaty authorised both parties to intervene in each other's territories in wartime emergencies, though neither side ever saw fit to do so. But despite the existence of these treaties, there is little to suggest any warm relationship between the two powers during this time. Indeed, it is likely that these treaties were made simply to keep each other out of their respective spheres of influence, rather than to foster any form of friendly relationship. Indeed, it is notable that neither side requested the other's aid against Pyrrhus, despite both being placed in dire situations during their respective wars. Even so, the desire by both sides to avoid conflict is clear, even in the final years before the outbreak of hostilities. And yet only 14 years later, the two sides would find themselves at war. Hey everybody, Charles here again. Just wanted to take a quick moment to talk to you about this video's sponsor for today, The Great Courses Plus. I've been a follower of The Great Courses myself for the last couple of years. The lectures on human history were just about the only thing that would get me through my morning bus ride to work back when it was an hour long. Now you can enjoy their lectures too with The Great Courses Plus, an on-demand educational video streaming service that's offering you a free trial today. This service offers a huge library of lectures and courses from world-leading professors and institutions, over 11,000 in total. I've just finished Cooking Across the Ages with Professor Ken Albauer, and let me tell you, some of those recipes really made me rethink the idea of attending a medieval banquet. It's not just history either. Great Courses Plus also offers courses on art, science, maths, literature, and just about any topic that might tickle your interests. Just visit thegreatcoursesplus.com/thehistocrat or click on the link in the description to start your free trial today. Before we examine the reasons behind the outbreak of the Punic Wars, let us briefly assess the sources we have available for their events. In examining these sources, we immediately face a number of problems. The largest by far is that they are one-sided, as no known Punic account of the war has survived the fall of the city in 146 BC. Instead, we must rely entirely on the accounts of Roman and Greek authors, many of whom go to great extents to cast the Carthaginians as the villains. The second problem is that, with one slight exception, each of these surviving accounts dates from well after the end of these conflicts. We do know of a few relatively contemporary accounts for the First Punic War, those of the 3rd century Roman author Fabius Pictor, and his Greek contemporaries Philinius of Agrigentum and Timaeus. Unfortunately for us, however, these writings are now largely lost, appearing only as references in the work of later authors. In addition to this, we almost have an account by Cato, the 3rd and 2nd century BC Roman politician. Having served in the Second Punic War, Cato would himself contribute to the outbreak of the Third War, only to die before the conflict itself could begin. Despite this, only a few small scraps of his account of the First and Second Punic Wars have survived. Instead, the closest we have to a contemporary account is that of the Greek author Polybius. Originally a statesman from the city of Megalopolis in southern Greece, Polybius spent much of the period after 167 BC as a hostage in Rome. During this time, he was an important eyewitness to the Third Punic War, even accompanying the Roman commander Scipio Aemilianus during the final destruction of Carthage in 146 BC. Throughout this period, he wrote a series of histories that covered the events of all three wars, which, with the exception of the second, have survived almost in their entirety. In addition to his practical experience of the final Punic War, Polybius is also distinguished from his contemporaries in holding that it was a historian's job only to report what details he could verify from written sources or interviews of first or second-hand eyewitnesses. As such, he is generally considered the most reliable source of information on the period by modern historians. Outside of Polybius, our other major sources include a largely complete account of the First Punic War by the 1st century BC Greek author Diodorus of Sicily, who is happy to emphasise Roman arrogance and grandeur alike. To this we can add the surviving work of his near contemporary, Livy, who provides a substantial pro-Roman account of the Second Punic War as part of his larger Roman history. Next we have the more literary works of the 1st and 2nd century AD author Plutarch, who provides biographies of a number of significant figures from the Second Punic War as part of his series of parallel lives. Lastly, we have the dispersed and often fragmentary work of the 2nd century AD Greek author Appian, and the frequently embellished account of the 3rd century Roman statesman Lucius Cassius Dio. Whilst the latter's history only partially survives, the bulk of his work can be reconstructed from an epitome written by the much later author, the 12th century Byzantine chronicler Zanaris. To these major accounts, we can also add minor details from authors such as Cicero, Cornelius Nepos, and Suetonius, who occasionally provide us with references to characters or events throughout the wars. With the caveats surrounding these sources in mind, let's take a look at the events that sparked the outbreak of the First Punic War, which could be traced back to 289 BC. After the death of the Syracusan ruler Agathocles that year, the large mercenary armies he had employed in his wars against Carthage were disbanded. One of these groups, a companion force later known as the Mamertines, journeyed northwards to the Greek city of Messana, known today as Messina. At some point in the next few years, this group succeeded in taking control of the city, and proceeded to use it as a base from which to raid the neighbouring areas of Sicily. Around the same time, the city of Rhegium in southern Italy appealed for aid to their Roman allies against Tarentum. Another group of 4,000 companions were duly dispatched to occupy the city. Upon arriving in Rhegium, however, they followed the example of the Mamertines, seizing the city for themselves and massacring its male citizens. With the Romans occupied by the war with Pyrrhus, this group retained control of Rhegium for another 5 years. After the fall of Tarentum in 272 BC, however, the Romans turned their attention to the city, defeating the mutineers in 270 BC. Around the same time, Mamertines were increasingly drawn into conflict with neighbouring Syracuse, now ruled by a vigorous new tyrant named Hero. After an indecisive battle sometime around 269 BC, hostilities would be renewed between the two sides in 264 BC, when Hero's army inflicted a crushing defeat on the Mamertine forces at the river Longinus. With Messana itself now threatened by Syracusan forces, the Mamertine sent out two desperate missives seeking allies, one to the Carthaginians in the west, another east across the straits to Rome. To the Carthaginians, the advantages of such an alliance would have been clear. Having spent the last century strengthening its hold on the western cities of Sicily, the chance to extend its rule to the east and potentially take control of the lucrative trade routes across the straits to Italy was not one that it could pass up. At the same time, the chance to check the power of the Syracusan ruler would have been welcome, as the last thing Carthage would have desired was another king in the vein of Agathocles. A small relief force under an officer named Hannibal was duly dispatched, and let into the city shortly thereafter. Meanwhile in Rome, the Mamertines' call for aid seems to have received a mixed reception. If we go by Polybius, the offer of an alliance seems to have been warmly received by the two consuls for that year, but the Senate was less receptive. At issue seems to have been the charge of hypocrisy that such an alliance would entail. To quote Polybius,
"The Romans remained undecided for a long time because it was glaringly obvious how unjustifiable it would be for them to send help. After all, only a short while earlier they had executed some of their fellow citizens for having treacherously turned against the people of Rhegium. It would be inexcusable if the very next thing they did was to try and help the Mamertines, who had behaved in almost exactly the same way in both Messana and Rhegium."
Counterbalancing this charge of hypocrisy, however, was what he claimed to be a growing fear amongst the Romans of Carthaginian expansion in Sicily, the conquest of which would leave them within striking distance of southern Italy. Eventually, the Senate appears to have been unable to decide on a course of action. Nonetheless, the chance for military glory was not one that the consuls were willing to pass up. With the Senate unable to decide, they took their war proposals to the people's assemblies instead. According to Polybius, the public was easily swayed by their promises of plundered wealth and glory, and the Romans dispatched Appius with a force to relieve the city. The events presented by Polybius are plausible enough on the surface, as are the Roman reasons for intervention. Similar reasons are given by both Diodorus of Sicily and Cassius Dio by way of Zonaris. Indeed, the latter claims that a violent confrontation between the two had become inevitable after the Roman conquest of southern Italy, given the proximity of Sicily to their newly acquired territory. Quote,
"The latter readily voted to aid them, knowing that in case the Mamertines should not secure an alliance with them, they would have recourse to the Carthaginians, and then the Carthaginians would master all Sicily, and from there cross over into Italy. For this island is such a short distance away from the mainland that the story goes that it was itself once a part of the mainland. So the island, thus lying off Italy, seemed to invite the Carthaginians to lay claim also to the land over opposite. Could they but occupy Sicily first, and the possession of Messana assured to its masters the control of the strait also."
On further scrutiny, however, there are problems with this narrative. For a start, no great evidence has come to light that the First Punic War was premeditated. No ancient source mentions any great military build-up on either side, as might be expected if a major war was anticipated. The idea of the Romans fearing Carthaginian expansionism is also difficult to take at face value, as the extent of Carthage's Sicilian territory had changed little in the decades preceding the Mamertines' call for aid. If anything, the opposite is true, as Carthage would have witnessed a dramatic increase in Roman territory in neighbouring Italy over the previous century. Instead, a number of modern scholars, such as Dexter Hoyos, have hypothesised that the initial cause of Rome's involvement in northern Sicily may have been more to check the actions of Syracuse than those of Carthage. This dynamic seems to tally better with Polybius's description of the Roman populace as worn out from their previous wars, as a short war against the resource-rich and militarily limited Syracuse would likely have been more profitable than one with Carthage. In this fashion, Rome may also have been seeking to expand its hegemony in the guise of aiding an ally, as it had done so multiple times in the course of the previous century. Finally, some of the information given to us by Polybius also seems to go against what is known of Roman society during this time. As the historian Adrian Goldsworthy points out in his book, The Fall of Carthage, control of the people's assemblies during this time would still have been weighted in favour of Rome's wealthier citizens. This fact alone would have made it unlikely that any war would have been approved without the agreement of the leading men of the Senate, many of whom would still have come from wealthy families. But whatever the exact reasons behind this decision, the end result was that Rome chose to intervene. A force was dispatched south under the command of Appius Claudius, where it would attempt to cross into Sicily for the first time. Upon hearing word of the Roman decision, the Mamertines responded by expelling the Carthaginian garrison from the city. Whilst there is no sign that the Carthaginian commander resisted the Mamertines' expulsion, his government appears to have reacted angrily. In addition to executing their hapless commander, the Carthaginians also dispatched a force to besiege the city. Led by a man by the name of Hanno, this force also came with a navy, which moved to block Appius's first attempt to cross into Sicily. Despite this, the Punic commander willingly returned the ships and crews that he had seized from the Romans. When Appius refused to come to terms, he left the Roman general with a warning. To quote Dio by way of Zanaris,
"When the other would listen to nothing, he threatened that he would never permit the Romans even to wash their hands in the sea."
In preparation for the Romans' arrival, Hanno also made an unprecedented alliance with Hero at Syracuse, who may have been somewhat eager to drive the foreign invaders from Sicily before they could acquire a foothold. Despite Hanno's threats, the second Roman attempt at crossing would prove successful. Calling up vessels from Rome's allies in southern Italy, Appius successfully eluded the Carthaginian fleet and landed in Sicily. Arriving outside of Messana, the consul appears to have attempted to negotiate with both sides, who rebuffed his efforts. With diplomatic options exhausted, he chose then to come to the aid of his allies in the city. According to Polybius, Appius chose to attack the Syracusan forces first. Despite their alliance, Hanno seems to have made no effort to aid Hero against the Romans, and he was soon defeated and forced to retreat. After driving the Syracusans off, Appius then turned and defeated Hanno's forces too. Both of Rome's opponents retreated, and Messana was secured. The intervention of the Romans at Messana marks the effective beginning of the First Punic War, a conflict that would last for another 23 years. At the time, neither side would have guessed how long this war would drag on. There is even good reason to think that after Messana, a negotiated peace could have been made between the two sides, or indeed at any point during the first 2 years of the war. After all, such an agreement is exactly what occurred between Rome and Hero the next year. After dispatching two consular armies to Sicily in 263 BC, the Romans succeeded in bottling up Hero in Syracuse, after which he negotiated a settlement to become a Roman ally. In 264 BC, Carthage was far too large for the Romans to subjugate it in such a manner, but this example indicates that the Romans were willing to come to the bargaining table. At the same time, it is equally possible that the expansion of Roman hegemony to the edge of Carthaginian territory would have made a larger war inevitable, as had happened with all of Rome's previous neighbours. By the end of 262 BC, however, the chance for a more limited war had passed. It was this year that Rome marched their armies into southern Sicily, where they laid siege to the Carthaginian-aligned city of Agrigentum. Here for the first time the massed armies of both sides would meet in full-scale battle. Its outcome would make total war inevitable. Hey folks, Charles here again. Just wanted to say a quick thank you for watching the video. If you'd like to stay up to date on where I am with making new videos, You can always follow me over on Twitter at twitter.com/the_histocrat. And if you'd like to support the channel, I'm also running a small Patreon over at patreon.com/thehistocrat. And whilst you're here, maybe consider checking out Stefan's video on the life of a Carthaginian merchant. Or alternatively, History Time Now has a video on the origins of the Phoenicians, the civilization that gave birth to the Carthaginians. That's it for me, folks. See you all next time.